If you viewed my NAND or NOR video all the way to the end, you'll recognize this circuit. It is a 16-instruction microprocessor I designed for a homework assignment in a class I took years ago. When I found the program Logisim, I figured it would be nice to put this CPU in it and see if the design works. This video is also useful to anyone who wonders, what can you do with ANDs, ORs, NANDs, and NORs anyway? Or anyone who wants to know how to simulate digital logic circuits. Since Logisim is a Java program, you'll need at least Java version 5, also known as 1.5, to run it. It's also known as Java Runtime Environment, or JRE. You can download Logisim and Java for free from the addresses here, or refer to the description area of this video. Don't be overwhelmed by all the links. I provided as many different links as possible, since over time websites change and go away. With Logisim, you can drag various components onto the workspace. For some reason, this component defaults to 5 input lines and medium size, so I'll change it to 2 lines and narrow. You can also connect these components with wires. You can move them about. You can duplicate them. And you can delete them. It's important to discuss an attribute of some of these components that could become an issue in your design. I'll draw a pulse waveform. Some components are triggered by the pulse on an edge that might not be as expected. As expected, triggering can occur on a high level or a low level, but it can also occur on the rising or positive edge, or the falling or negative edge. And some components can only be triggered on a rising or falling edge. Later on, you'll see how this can cause problems. So here's my processor design in Logisim. By the way, if I remember correctly, the teacher never collected or graded the homework, so there was no absolute way of knowing if my design was correct. Also, for the assignment, we didn't have to determine things like edge triggering, whether it's rising or falling, etc. So there was a little bit of adjusting required to get the CPU to work in Logisim. By the way, the original design was a 20-bit processor, but to make things easier, I made it an 8-bit processor in Logisim. It would be rather trivial to make it a 20-bit as designed. This is an encoder. Logisim only has priority encoders. All that is needed for this CPU is a simple encoder. A simple encoder takes 2 to the power of n input lines and converts the input to an n-bit binary value. The input lines are considered one hot, meaning only one of them would be high at a time. An encoder consists of OR gates. Here's a multiplexer, also known as a mux. It outputs one of up to 2 to the power of n input lines depending on the n-bit binary select line. It can consist of ANDs, ORs, and NOTs. This is a decoder. A decoder does the opposite of an encoder. It converts an n-bit binary value to its unique associated output line, which is any one of 2 to the power of n. It consists of AND and NOT gates. This decoder selects the desired instruction. This is a D flip-flop. A D flip-flop remembers the input value. It can consist of NANDs and NOTs. Also, this is a JK flip-flop. It can consist of NANDs and NOTs. In this configuration, the remembered value toggles. These flip-flops create a resettable and haltable fetch-execute cycle. Here's a counter. A counter stores an n-bit value and updates by either incrementing by 1 in this case, or loading a new value. It consists of JK flip-flops, ANDs, ORs, and NOTs. This functions as the CPU's program counter, or PC for short. It points to a location in RAM where the next instruction to be executed resides. Similarly, this is a register. It stores an n-bit value. It consists of D flip-flops. This one functions as the CPU's instruction register, or IR for short. The instruction register also contains the Z register, which can be thought of as a virtual register, since it is really part of the instruction and not a separate register. We need a splitter as well. It splits a multi-bit value into desired pieces, or combines pieces into a desired multi-bit value. This one separates the opcode from the Z register. The other splitter grabs the most significant bit of the Y register to signal a negative number in the Y register, assuming the value is a signed value. This is a controlled buffer. It's also known as a tri-state buffer or a tri-state gate. It outputs the input if the control line is 1. This is used to allow the RAM's data line to be used for both reading and writing. Finally, to make the circuit nicer looking, tunnels are used. A tunnel represents a wire connecting all tunnels of the same name together. Later, we'll need a bit extender, which extends the bit width of the input. Logisim didn't have an arithmetic logic unit, or ALU, so I had to make one. It's rather straightforward, just an adder and subtractor selected by a mux. You can also see what adders and subtractors consist of. Internally, a CPU moves data between the different parts of the machine, RAM to registers, registers to RAM, RAM to ALU, ALU to register, etc. This is the instruction set this CPU executes. Load I transfers the Z register to the Y register. Load transfers the memory contents pointed to by the Z register to the Y register. Jump changes the program counter to the specified location. Data in transfers data from a hypothetical external device to the Y register. Strobe sends a pulse to the external device, presumably to tell it to send data. NOAP doesn't do anything. You can most likely figure out the rest. The instructions are orchestrated by this decoder, with each line representing one of the instructions from load I to NOAP. Here's the various things that are done to execute each instruction. By the way, the port numbers refer to the numbers written next to the encoders, etc., on my homework solution shown at the beginning of this video. Notice on opcode 3 and 10, which are store and jump II, there's an asterisk that indicates that step isn't implemented. This is because I don't know of any good way to select two different encoder ports on the same encoder at the same time. I thought maybe you could use two encoders and have a control buffer or mux select which address line goes to the address bus during different parts of the pulse, but that seems too complicated and kludgy. So for now, those instructions aren't fully implemented. To prove this original CPU design does at least somewhat work, let's load a few instructions and run them. This will do a few strobes, NOAPs, a transfer from external device to the Y register, and a halt. So let's pulse it. You can see the activated lines in bright green. A CPU works by doing a fetch-execute cycle, first fetching an instruction from RAM, putting it in the instruction register, and then executing it. The flip-flops make sure the fetch-execute cycle occurs continuously as long as the CPU is in a running state. This design does have a few problems, though, so let's fix the problems, and while we're at it, improve the design some. The first problem is that for opcode 5 and 7, which add and subtract using a value in memory, there was no path to send the Z register value to the address bus. This is solved by adding two lines to this OR. Another problem was that there was no prefetch line. This solves that. As for improvements, I added some LEDs to visually show the contents of the Y register, the instruction register, and the RAM data line. I also put in a bit extender that I mentioned earlier. It's there because the registers require an 8-bit value, but the part of the instruction that is the Z register is only 4 bits. So the four most significant bits of the instruction are combined with the four new most significant bits, which are set to zero in this extender, to form the contents of the essentially virtual Z register. This arrangement guarantees that only the Z register part of the instruction is sent to the other parts of the processor that require the Z register. There's also some triggering circuitry added to the program counter because of what I consider the kind of odd way Logisim's counter is controlled. A CPU that only does addition and subtraction isn't very useful, so let's improve it further. I didn't want to add another bit to the opcode part of the instruction, which would then reduce the Z register to 3 bits. Besides, that would add 14 instruction lines I don't need, since I would only need 2. Or maybe 4 with 12 lines unused. So I figured I would take over the no-op instruction to trigger a JK flip-flop to toggle which set of mathematical operations you want, add and subtract, or multiply and divide. Also, the ALU needs to be modified, adding a multiplier and a divider, and also changing the mux size. There's still a problem, though. It's in the jump instructions. During the execute cycle, the correct Z value is at the mux and is being selected. The PC is triggered on the rising edge of its trigger. But at that point, the correct mux line is in the process of being selected. So the PC gets the value in RAM instead. If it could be triggered on a high instead, it probably would work. This is the problem with triggering I mentioned earlier. I've tried putting a high-level triggered register between the mux and the PC. It worked, but had bad side effects. So let's just take out the mux instead, and wire the Z register directly to the load line of the PC. The other jump instructions definitely will never work now, but they weren't working before, so no harm. By the way, I also added reset lines to each register so that the contents are cleared when reset is hit. It's not necessary, but it's a good idea. Now let's do something nice with this CPU. Here are the programs that I'll run. The strobes are just there to allow each of the LEDs to stay on the same amount of time. I probably need another strobe in there, but it's close enough. Remember that if the most significant bit of the Y register is 1, which in the LED display is the leftmost LED, the value is considered negative. Because of this, in program 1, the skip neg instruction is used to reverse the direction of the LEDs once the leftmost position is reached. So let's run it. This will create a kit effect from the Knight Rider TV show, or if you prefer, a Cylon effect. Let's pulse it automatically. Unfortunately, there's no instruction to determine if a value is 1, or any specified number for that matter, so we can't reverse the direction back. Thus, the effect ends. Program 2 creates an effect that is fully repeatable. Well, as you can see, the CPU isn't perfect, but it does run. As I stated in my NAND and NOR videos, it would have been nice to create the CPU as an integrated circuit in my university's integrated circuit manufacturing lab. With Logisim, the design could be tested before committing it to silicon, saving a lot of trouble. In Logisim, components such as counters, muxes, etc. aren't built up by building upon basic logic gates. They are simulated by software procedures or classes. In order to show what these components consist of, I had to build them myself in Logisim. By doing this, I figured out some statistics. If the original CPU design with corrections and 8-bit rather than 20-bit data width was built, it would require 348 NANDs, 341 ANDs, 8 NORs, 130 ORs, and 164 NOTs. If this was implemented using a CMOS design, it would require 2,289 PMOS and 2,289 NMOS transistors for a total of 4,578 transistors. The 20-bit CPU would require at least 10,458 transistors. I'm closing in on you, Pentium. Well, not really at all. Give Logisim a try. Maybe you can use it to come up with an even better CPU.